is the feeling of being a failure and not a success like everyone else. You see, men who face what is called the midlife crisis look at their life and become very frustrated because they see that almost half of their lives is over and they still have not accomplished their goals or their dreams in life. They want to be successful at something in this world and they want to be able to say, I did this, I was able to accomplish this, I did it my way, and I became successful. So the pressure from the world to be a success is enormous in our time. But even among the preachers, there is pressure to be successful. That is why in our time, in churches, the emphasis today is on having a large church. And because of that, it leaves many pastors feeling they are failures because their church is not large like another man's ministry. So because of this concept of success, we try to compare ourselves to other people and we try to outdo each other. And in doing so, we're spending so much time, energy, effort, and we are being drained without really reaching that success because what we are shooting for is something that is only temporary. You may be successful today in this world, but tomorrow you may be a nobody. So the reason why we are living in such a way is because this world is putting so much pressure for us to live only for today and to live only for this world. For this world, the word of God is not important. For this world, eternal things are not important anymore. For this world, what is important is money. What is important is fame, popularity, power, and if you have that, then the world will deem you as a successful person. They have no concern for eternal or spiritual matters. And because of this, as we do not have a proper definition of the word success, then it affects us. Because how you define success will affect your behavior, your attitude, and your outlook in life. So, what I desire to do today is to look at the two viewpoints regarding success and let us contrast them from each other. There are two views regarding success. Number one is God's view, and number two is man's view. And on the issue of success, they are totally opposite with each other. How God sees success is different from how man sees or views success. For this reason, you need to make sure that as a Christian, we are following the right philosophy concerning this matter of success. Because failure to do so can lead us to depression, disillusionment, discouragement, and we will be defeated in our Christian life and the ministry. So let us try to look at this and see biblical success, or that success is always according to the word of God and not according to the views of man or the philosophies of man. Number one, let us look at power versus submission. Power versus submission. The idea of this word is you are successful if you have the power and influence. That is why today, if you go to Facebook or YouTube, there are so many what we call influencer. And they are the people that, to whom the people are looking up to. They're listening to them. It is as if when they say something, that is the authority. And if they're going to follow what they have done in life, then you are going to be successful. Why? Because if you have power and you have influence, then this word is going to put you on a pedestal. But God's idea of success is not power, but it is submission and humility. Amen. The person who is successful in the sight of God is the person who humbles himself and the person who submits his will to the will of God. That is how God measures success. You see, God did not call us to be successful, but He called us to be faithful. That is what we need to understand. God puts premium on faithfulness. You see, many times people will turn their back on the Lord. Why? If they become financially successful. You see, successful people in this world, as the world measures them, basically do not need God. That is what they think. Because they think that they were self-made persons. Because they think that they made it without the help of God. Because they think that the reason why they have this power, why they have this influence, is because of what they have done in their lives. They do not recognize that everything that we have is only because of the grace of God. It is God's gift to each and every one of us, but they try to get all the credit and remove God from everything that they have accomplished in life. You see, the Apostle Paul was like that before. He thought that what he's doing is because of his knowledge. It is because of his influence. It is because of his being very religious. It is because of his zeal in Judaism. But one day, by the grace of God, he met the Lord Jesus Christ. He encountered the Lord Jesus Christ, and his life changed. And now he measures success as serving Jesus and not serving himself or Judaism or the Pharisees wherein he was a part of. So they feel that they don't need God anymore if they have the things of this world. That is what the people are thinking, or how people measures success. You see, when success turns a man's head, it leaves him looking on the wrong direction. Yung bang lumaki ni ulo mo because of success. You say, so humble people with humble beginnings, and when success came into their lives, then you cannot even reach them anymore. They cannot stoop down anymore. They think that they're better than you. They think that they're better than many people, because they believe that they have made it because of themselves. They do not realize that God can remove whatever success they may think they have in life in one click of a finger. You see, success is not about how much we have, but it is about how we obey God in our lives. How we submit to the will of God. But if success could make the heart swell like it does to the head, then our world will become a better place. Success should not go to your head. It should go to your heart, and then your heart will feel for the need of the people, and your heart will desire to be of service to the people. That is real success. Amen? Glorifying God and serving people. You see, Moses turned his back on power and submit his will to God. We can see that the Apostle Paul can be a man of power. He can be a man of wealth. He can be a man of fame. But he counted it all but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 8. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. You see, what the world longs for, what the world wanted to have, Paul says, they are nothing but dung compared to the excellency of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So real success is not about power, but it is about submitting ourselves to God. Look at Luke chapter 22, verse number 42. Luke 22, 42. Saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. But the Lord Jesus Christ says, nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Amen? It should be according to the will of the Father, it should be according to the will of God. It should be according to God's design in our lives. And what we do, if it will glorify God, then that is success. And it will only happen if we will submit ourselves unto God. Amen. Because only a submissive person will obey the word of God. But if you are full of yourself, then there is no more room for God. And there is no more room for humility. James 4:7 says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You see, the devil will tempt us. But when we submit ourselves to God, then the devil will not be able to become successful in tempting us and removing us from the will of God. So success in the Bible is about submission and not power. Number two, freedom versus responsibility. Freedom versus responsibility. You see, this world is consumed with doing its own thing and having its own way, no matter how its actions affect others. They don't care. As long as I'm happy, as long as I am satisfied, as long as it will gratify myself, then I am going to do it. During the time of the hippies, this is what they always say: if it feels good, do it. If it will make you happy, do it. You follow your heart. Wherever it wants to lead you, as long as it will make you happy and satisfied and comfortable, then do it. Ladies and gentlemen, as believers, we are to be concerned about our responsibility to God and to other people, not only our responsibility to the flesh. But it should be God and other people. You see, joy as an acronym means Jesus first, other second, and yourself last. You see, the thing is that people just want to do whatever they want to do. They said, I am free. I must be able to do what I want to do, without realizing that their freedom, or in expressing their freedom, they're actually trampling the freedom of other people. You know, I will sing if I want to sing. Well, that may be your freedom. But if it is in the middle of the night, please don't do it. Why? Because people have the freedom to sleep. They have the right to sleep. Let them sleep. Amen? You may be free to do those things, but you must exercise freedom responsibly. So it is not about you doing what you want to do, but we are free, listen, to do the will of God in our lives. That is our freedom. Because doing sin or committing sin is not freedom, it is bondage. You are bondage to sin. Therefore, you are under the penalty of death. So why do we have to be responsible to God? Why do we have to be responsible to other people? Why? Because we belong to the Lord and should not live for ourselves or to please ourselves. You see, Paul says, for to me, to live is Christ. Living for us is for Christ and to Christ and to live up the Lord and to glorify the Lord. The reason why we are still living is because we want to live this life for the glory of God. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it for the glory of God. That is our responsibility. And if you say liberty, we are free to serve God and to live the name of God in our lives. You don't live for yourself. Look at Romans chapter 14, 7 to 8. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord. You see, let us look at how we are living today. Are we living for the Lord? Is our lives being lived for the glory of God? For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. Meaning to say, when God redeemed us from the penalty of sin, we became the property of God. We belong to God. You know, Paul says that, know ye not that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that we belong to God, that we are not our own, because we are bought with a price. Therefore, he says, glorify God. Glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So if I belong to God, then I need to be responsible, a responsible child of God, or a responsible property of the Lord. But this self is not mine to use, but this self is for God's disposal. That whatever he wills in our lives, that is what we are going to do. Look at Isaiah chapter 43, verse number 1. But now, thus saith the Lord, that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee, I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. That is why Israel has a great responsibility before God, towards God. And that is why God is mindful of every words and every actions that the Israelites are doing, and whatever they do will have consequences or will have rewards or punishment according to how they obey God. Because it is their responsibility to glorify God as they were redeemed and bought by God with a price. He set them to become an example among many nations so that the light will be dispensed into all the world, and people will glorify God because of Israel. And the same thing with us, that we need to be the light of this world, that people may be saved and glorify God because of the church. But the question is, what are we doing? Are we living a life that is responsible to God? Or are we living our lives according to how we want to live it? There are so many Frank Sinatras in the Christian world. I did it my way. And you look at the lyrics of that song. It is all about self. And you will see how futile it is to live for self. Because he even bite a chunk that he could not even chew. He even tried to embrace something that he cannot embrace. And that is what self can do, because we are nothing without God. Amen. That is why when it comes to success, it is not about freedom to do whatever we want to do, but do things according to the word and according to the will of God. Amen. And that is success. Number three, gain versus giving. Gain versus giving. You see, the world feels that money is the criteria for success. Why do we know Bill Gates? Why do we know Rockefeller? Why do we know Steve Jobs? Why do we know most of these people? Why? Because they're wealthy. Because they have money. And the world looked up to them and they said, that there is a successful man. Why? Because money is most often than not the sole criteria for success as far as this world is concerned. So for this reason, money is to be gained at all cost. And the Bible is true. Because the Bible says that money is the root of all evil. And you will see that many, many times people are using evil deeds in order to gain money. You see, so many people are manipulators. We're talking about climate change and how people in position, in power, try to use this in order to enrich themselves. They manipulate people. They're charlatans. Why? Because of their love for money. You see, the love of money is the root of all evil. Money is not evil in itself. But if you love money more than God, then it's going to be the root of evil that you will do in your life. There is simply no serving God and mammon. God must be first and mammon must be a tool in order to glorify God. Amen? So if we're not going to do that, then we are going to miss the mark of how to live this life with the blessings of the Lord and use them in order to glorify God. You see, the Bible in Mark 8:36 asks the question, what shall it profit a man? What shall it profit a man? Even if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul. You see, by chasing after money, you are wasting the opportunity to be saved. You are wasting the opportunity to have a good relationship with God, with your family, and even with mankind. You are wasting your life. Why? Because you will chase it all your life, and once you have it, you will see that you're almost or in the end of your life. How can it profit you anymore? You see, there was a queen in England, I do not know who, but she's about to die. And she told the doctor, £1,000,000 for a year of life. The doctor says, Mom, your money cannot buy you life. It cannot. If it is your appointed time, then you're going to die. Why? Because God is in control, not you. But sad to say, people with money, they think that they are in control. What is the saying in this word? He who has the money has the power. So that is what they think. But power to what? Power to do evil, power to manipulate people, power to do those things that will gratify self. It is good if you're going to use money as a servant for the glory of God. But once it takes the place of God, then you are doomed. Look at Job chapter 21, verse number 13. You know, we can find a lot of wisdom with Job. They spend their days in wealth, and in a moment, go down to the grave. You see, you spend your days, your life, in amassing wealth. And when you die, you leave everything behind. Amen? You cannot bring anything to where you are going. It may be heaven, or it may be hell. You see, Chinese are burning paper cars and paper house and paper money and all of these things because they think that it will help them in their journey to their eternal destination. But ladies and gentlemen, no. When you die, you leave all. You see, one of the most powerful men in the world is Alexander the Great. And when Alexander the Great is about to die, he told his soldiers that if you're going to, before you bring me to my last destination in this world, you put two holes beside my coffin and let my hand go out of that hole and march me so that the people will see that even the most powerful man who ever lived will bring nothing out of this world. The Bible says we came into this world with nothing. And surely we will leave this world with nothing. But praise God, we can send something if we will serve God in our lives. Amen? And do those things that have eternal value than those things without. You see, there is a successful person who lived in this world, and his name is Rockefeller. And I would like to read what he said. He said, I have made millions of dollars, but they have brought me no happiness. Why? You see, if you're going to imagine, maybe Pastor, just $100,000 will make me very, very happy. But he said, I have made millions of dollars, but they have brought me no happiness. So when John Rockefeller was 53, his life was a wreck. In chaos. He's miserable. And he was the richest man in the world during the time. He was sick physically, mentally, and emotionally. There was no joy in his life at all. His life was transformed when he decided, we're just talking about this word, when he decided to be a giver rather than a getter. He began to give away his millions, and he started the Rockefeller Foundation, and it was dedicated to fighting disease and ignorance in the world. He lived to be 98 years old and was a very happy man because of his new definition of success. Success is not how much you gain, but how much you give. Why? Because you cannot retain what you try to gain. But what you are going to retain in life and in eternity are the things that you have given to other people. Why? God loveth a cheerful giver. Even in our life as a Christian, even in our life as a member of the church, whenever we give to God, it must always be cheerful. Why? Because God's nature is to give. And He loves giving people. And He loves people who wanted to lose things for the glory of God. Because God knew that whatever we will lose for Him, that is what we will gain in eternity. Amen. So success is not about gain, but it is about giving. So the question today is, the first question is, have you given your life to Christ? Are you saved? You need to do it. And if you are saved, have you given all of your life for the service of God? Or are you here in this world just to gain? To amass money, to amass wealth, and to be satisfied, to gratify your flesh, yourself, and not to glorify God in your life. So let us be careful in how we measure success. People may be rich, but it doesn't mean that they are successful. Because the Bible even says that a man's life is not regarding the possession that he has, but it is about things that he has done for the Lord. That is why when the Lord Jesus Christ called his apostles, what happened? They left all and followed him. That is what we call success. Number four, immediate fulfillment versus lasting achievement. Immediate fulfillment versus lasting achievement. The motto of this word is live for now. That is the motto of this word. Let us eat, let us drink, let us be merry, for maybe tomorrow we die. So let us live for now. You see, men will ignore the price tag of success. The reason many successful men are so lonely is they have trampled and sacrificed so many friends on the way up the ladder of success. You see, they try to defraud people in order to be successful. They try to manipulate people in order to become successful. And that now that they are successful, they do not even know if they really have true friends anymore. Because if you are successful, the people that may surround you are people who want something from you. But if you really want to know who your real friends are in times of adversity, they will be there by your side. And that's the reason why the Lord Jesus Christ is a friend that sticketh more than a brother. Because He's always there. He will never leave us nor forsake us. I remember when I went on deputation in the United States of America, and then I went back to the Philippines. They thought that deputation is a job. It is as if you went to America and work and gather so much money and all of these things. But I went there to present the ministry, and then I went back to the Philippines, and all of a sudden I have so many relatives that I do not know. you know, I'm so and so, the cousin of your father or your mother, or all of a sudden they have so many relatives, and even my enemies are all of a sudden became my friends, and they will come almost every night, almost every day, and when they come, they will, of course, pleasantries and all of these things, and before they go, Brother Joel, can you spare me 1,000 pesos because, you know, we need this, my children, etc., etc., almost every night. And that's why Sister Maribel, after maybe 2 weeks, said, let me handle this, not you. Because I do not know, that's my weakness. It's very hard for me to say no. But now I've learned. You may try it, but I've already practiced saying no. And I'm going to let you know about it. but that's really my weakness. So Sister Maribel said, let me handle it. And then all of a sudden, they stopped coming. And then, when everything went back to normal, now they're my enemies again. And they're not my relatives anymore. Why? Because now I learned to say no. But whenever I say yes, then they're happy, then they're my friend, then they consider me as a top guy because of what I can give them. But ladies and gentlemen, if you want success, do not do it at the expense of your family. Do not do it at the expense of your friends. Do not do it at the expense of your integrity. Why? Because it's not going to be real success. Because real success will never compromise your spiritual health. It will never compromise your spiritual condition before God. If you lose your family to be financially successful or famous, you are not a successful person. You see, if having lots of money is the criteria of being successful, then Jesus was a failure. No pillow. No house. Almost have nothing of this world. But you see, he is the most successful person who ever lived. Not only because he was God, because he was able to do the will of God in his life, and everything that he has done have eternal weight of glory, and not only for the immediate. Or not only for the immediate fulfillment of the flesh, but for the glory of God. You see, God puts premium on hard-working people. He wants our labor to last. Losing your family, making moral compromise, and disobeying God's word to achieve success is not success at all. Listen, success is linked to obeying God's word and having the right priorities. The person who is successful has learned to work hard instead of depending on luck and lotteries. You see, as a Christian, you do not buy lottery tickets, but Pastor, I might win. I hope you will not. Because if you will win, then you will continue sinning. But the pastor said, well, it's okay. As long as you give your tithes, if you will win. You see, I was asked during my ordination, I was asked by one pastor that if one of your members won in a small-time lottery, that's wetting in the Philippines, are you going to accept the tithes? I said no. And the pastor said, okay, send your member to me. And I am going to accept him in our congregation and accept the money. And they even said, it doesn't matter if that money came from the devil. What's important is that we will use the money for the glory of God. You see, the means does not justify the end. The means must be right, and the end must be right. Because for the Lord, it must start right, and it will end up right. Amen? And that is real success. As the Bible defines it. You see, the person who is successful has learned to work hard. As I have said, instead of depending on luck and lotteries, God honors hard work, which does not rob your spiritual growth. You know, some people dream of worthy accomplishments while others are awake and they do it. Don't dream. Do it. You need to roll up your sleeve and be successful by doing hard work for the glory of God. If you want to be successful in the right things, learn to work hard, especially if you are in the Lord's work. Working for Christ yields lasting achievement. So that is what we need to shoot for. Things that will last for eternity. Not only things that will last for today. But that is our problem. We are only living for this world. We are only living for the satisfaction of the flesh. And we are not living for with eternity in view. Look at 2 John chapter 1, verse number 8. He says, look to yourselves, that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. We have to be careful as a Christian, that we need to have the right motive in everything that we are doing for God. Because if not, then we are going to lose our reward. So let us work for lasting achievement, eternal value, than only those things that can give us immediate fulfillment. Number 5, the applause of men versus the approval of God. The applause of men versus the approval of God. The world puts a big premium on the crowd's approval. Acceptance in the group is a must. No matter what the group is doing, whether it is right or wrong. That is why we have fraternities. What's important is you will be accepted. It doesn't matter if what you're doing is wrong. They don't even care if it is right or if it is wrong, as long as you are accepted or as long as you are approved by men. That's why people are doing things that are approved to men, and they do not even care if it is approved to God. What they care about are the accolades that they can receive. What they care about are the applause that men will give them. What they care about is that they be put in a pedestal. That is what this world is trying to get. And that is their definition of success. But you see, obeying the Lord and living a godly life as a Christian meets God's approval. If you are approved by this word, there is a big question in your relationship with God. Because the Bible says that the world will love its own. But if you love Jesus, if you obey God, if you follow Him, then as He was hated by the world, we will also be hated by the world. So as a Christian, it is not a popular life. It is not a life of fame. It should not be a life of fortune. But you see, sad to say, the devil has corrupted even our culture in the church. That now, pastors wanted to become popular. They wanted to become rich. And they want to become famous and powerful. That's why you see a pastor aspiring to become a congressman. And now, he has already kicked off his campaign to become a senator. And who knows? Maybe next election, vice president or the president, or he may aspire as the Pope of the Baptist people. Yeah, because he already proclaimed himself as the patriarch. Why? Because that is how the world measures success, and the world is entering the churches. So we are adopting their criteria instead of the criteria that God has given us in His Word. We are looking for the applause of men. That's why Brother Wilson emphasizes that even with the desire for the gift of the Holy Spirit, we want the gift that will put us in the spotlight. We do not want the servant's gifts, but we want the speaking gifts. We want those gifts that is glamorous. That you're the one standing behind the pulpit, and that you're the one preaching, and that people are seeing you, and that people are applauding you, clapping their hands, and telling you that you are a good preacher. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever God has given you, if you are faithful, then you are a success before God. Amen. You may be the pastor, but if you mess the church of God, then you're a failure. And don't you know that when you're in the spotlight, it puts so much pressure that only people who are fully submitted to God will become successful in that area of service. So many temptations, so many things that will pull you out of God's will. That is the reason why we must shoot for the approval of God and not the applause of men. You see, I remember that when we were in a Bible school, we have this preaching contest, and in that preaching contest, our homiletics teacher said that you must use illustrations and stories and things that will move the emotion of people, and that will make them smile, that will make them laugh, and that will make them clap their hands. And once you achieve that, then you are going to win the preaching contest. He even gave us an illustration. You must know how to make one part of the congregation cry and make the other part of the congregation laugh. And we said, sir, how can you do that? Very simple. You use a very sad illustration and you apply it with all your might. Use all the dramatics that you know. And then while showing your behind to the other group where there is a band-aid, and you have a hole in your pants. So while you're preaching here and they're crying, this group are laughing because of what they will see or what they can see. You see, they think that preaching is just an art. That preaching is a performance. That preaching is an entertainment. That they're going to use everything in order to get the approval of the congregation, to make them happy, to make them laugh, because by doing that they said, I am successful. No, ladies and gentlemen, a preaching is only successful if it will lift up the name of God. If we will see our condition as a sinner in need of God, and that if we will see that in our life, in order for us to achieve anything, it's only by the power of God. That is a successful preaching. It doesn't matter if you shout or if you do not shout. It doesn't matter if you're loud or not. It doesn't matter. What's important is you are preaching for the glory of God. Amen. That is what is important. Amen. That's why I really cannot forget when I was in Laguna, we have a guest preacher, not in our church, but in the sending church. And he was introduced as a very good preacher, a great preacher, and that is really what I do not understand. This is not competition. If you're a preacher, you're simply representing God. You represent God the best possible way. And the best possible way is for you not to be seen, so that they will see God. Or Jesus Christ, whenever we sing, whenever we preach, whatever we do, the Lord Jesus Christ must be seen and we must be approved before God. And then he read the text, and then he uses higher ground as his, I don't know if you're there, Sister Lily. Maybe you will remember as I'm telling the story. Higher ground. And the first point is he took a stool and he stand on top of that stool and he's preaching. And then in the second verse, he stood on top of the pulpit because it should be higher and higher. And on the third point, he said, I hope you have a rope so that I can climb the ceiling. And I hope that I will end up this preaching on at the roof of this building. Performance. He's performing. He's trying to make us applaud him. But the truth of the matter is, we almost did not see God because he's blocking the way. And sometimes preachers do not realize that people are in the church because they want to see Jesus, not the preacher. You are not the main man. The main man is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the center, not you. You're simply a spokesman. You represent him. You're just an ambassador. You are not him. But it must be the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, I have a favorite illustration that I always said that wherever you are, if you're a Christian, even if you're not at your home church, if Sunday comes and there is service time comes, you find the church and you attend. And then this person went out of town and then he tried his best to be at church, but he was too far. And then because he's a Christian, he saw a church, a large church, a big church, and he went there. And then he attended that church, and the pastor is a very charismatic pastor, bombastic, acrobatic, sort of a magician, like eating a fire, breathing fire, and doing every acrobatics in order to impress people. And then he was very impressive. And after the service, he went out and he said, "My, what a great preacher. What a great preacher." And then he drove. And again, it was almost service time. He's not yet at their home church. So he went to another church, a good-sized church. And he went inside. And as he went inside, the pastor is preaching about Jesus. He's preaching about his birth. He's preaching about his life. He's preaching about his death. How he suffered for us. How agonizing a death that they experienced because of my sin. And because of your sin. And because he wants to save us. And how he died. How he was buried and he's resurrected and sitting at the right hand of God interceding for us. And then after the service he went out with tears rolling down his eyes. He said, "What a great Savior. What a great Savior." And that should always be the case, that whenever we attend a church, we will see Jesus and not the personalities there. Singers, if you have a good voice, thank God for that. It is a gift. But please do not get the attention of people because of your great voice. Do not do things that will make people recognize you or applaud you, not the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, I told this many times, and I will tell you again. While we were in San Fernando, Pampanga, we have a classmate who got saved. Before she got saved, she was a singer in a nightclub. And she was gloriously saved. And then she surrendered her life to the Lord. She became a Bible student. And then carnality came in. And then there was a big moment in our church. And she was scheduled to give the special number before the preaching. And then he told me, "Brother Joel, I'm going to sing. And there will be goosebumps all over when I sing." And I said, "Oh, don't do that. Because if that happens, then we will all run to the toilet. And it might be crowded." That's what I told her. But then she sang a very good rendition of the song of Sandy Patty. She sang the song, "They Could Not." She sang it very well. With all of the technique that she learned from singing in the nightclub. And all the manipulation of the voice that she can do. And in the eyes of the world and in the eyes of the carnal Christians, it was a very successful rendition of the song. But do you know what happened? That was her last song. She lost her voice. Not that she cannot talk, but her singing voice is not there anymore. God removed it from her. Why? You are there for God, not for yourself. Success the applause of men or the approval of God. 1 Corinthians 1:31. But according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. Amen. We trust God. We put our faith and our confidence in God. And when we are approved to God, then it doesn't matter if we are not approved to people. Amen? Because people who loves God will approve of what we are doing if we are approved by God. Number six. Number six of the 38. Not 38. We are almost finished. Being served versus serving others. Being served versus serving others. This is the ultimate status symbol. Having people serve you. Amen. If people are serving you, then you must be a very successful person. But if you are the one serving, then you are not. Because you are maybe considered a low person as far as society is concerned. Listen to me. Success is not a goal to be sought after. But it is a byproduct of learning how to serve. Only serving people will become successful people. You see, the greatest one, the most successful one, is the one who serves. And the Lord Jesus Christ says, I came not to be minister unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. He was the one who washed the apostles' feet. He was the one who served them. Why? Showing the meaning of true success. That in order for you to be lifted up, you must stoop down and serve others. And if you can do that, then God will lift you up. And if it is God who will lift you up, nobody can pull you down. That is what we need to understand when it comes to success. You see, I have several quotations. There was this Danny Thomas, he said, all of us are born for a reason. But all of us don't discover why. And that's why we live a life of failure. It's because we did not even know the reason why we are here. Success in life has nothing to do with what you gain in life or accomplish for yourself. It is what you do for others. That is success. George Bush said, any definition of a successful life must include serving others. Without serving others, there can be no real success. Amen? Our aim should be service and not success. Your success is not determined by how many servants you have, but by how many men you serve. That is why if you have a servant's heart, you are already successful in the sight of God. Amen? Look at Matthew 23:11. Meron na? But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. Amen? Amen. We cannot see that in the Word. Look at the famous people. They're being served. They're not serving. They're using their money to hire servants. So many maids. So many people serving them. But you see, ladies and gentlemen, according to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you want to be the greatest, then you should be the servant of all. It is about humility. Amen. Not being boastful or being proud. Not trying to be number one, but trying to become a nobody. Because you see, if you want to be on top, there is so much competition. But there is no competition down there. Because they will not compete with you. They will esteem you as higher than themselves. Because that is what God wants His people to have. The mind of Jesus. In Philippians chapter 2. Galatians 5:13. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love, serve one another. Amen? It was emphasized by Brother Wilson this morning that we cannot be really united without love. Because if we love each other, then we will serve each other. But if there is no love, and if there is only love for self, then we will desire others to serve us and not the other way around. Number 7, we're almost finished. Self-gratification versus self-control. Self-gratification versus self-control. A person without Christ is constantly seeking for things to thrill him and to fill him. Why? Because our lives, or the life of people without Jesus, is empty. So we try to fill it with what we think that will make us satisfied. That is why people are trying drugs, wine, gambling, things that are evil in order to satisfy themselves, only to find out that there is really no satisfaction without the Lord Jesus Christ. For only Jesus can satisfy our soul. You may try to find satisfaction in any other things in this world, but you will not be satisfied. You will not be fulfilled without Christ. As Solomon, he tried to find satisfaction with women, 1,000 of them. And he said that they are bitter than death. He tried to find it with enormous wealth. And he said, they are just vanity. He has wisdom that came from God. But even that did not give him real satisfaction. But he said, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandment, for that is the whole duty of man. You see, wine, Solomon said, nothing. I've tried it. I've tried to find the summum bonum of life, or the highest good of life, and all is vanity except God. So if we have God in our lives, if we have the Lord Jesus Christ in our lives, then we are going to be satisfied. You see, success requires we be successful in the right areas of life. We are to be successful in faith, in character, in wisdom, self-control, patience, gentleness, love, integrity. That is the area that we must find success. Because if we have this trait, then we are going to look at those things that really matters to God, and not only the things that matters to us. Because what matters to us is actually vanity before God. Many people have tried that, and they all failed. But when they put their lives in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ and apply those virtues that the Christian life, the Holy Spirit can give them, then they will see real success is in self-control, not in just gratifying yourself. Look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 8. 2 Peter 1, 5 to 8. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren, amen, nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. It will give us a spiritual satisfaction if we are going to have self-control than just gratifying ourselves with the things that this world can offer. Because what is in this world? Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. How can you find success in that? How can you be truly happy with that? Oh no, Pastor, I've been to heaven many times by taking drugs. You might feel that you're in heaven And when that drugs kick in for a while, you might feel gratified. But there is a time that you will reach that area wherein every time you take that drug, you will feel that you are in hell than in heaven. Why? Because that is not God's design for you, for your body, for your satisfaction. God's design is that we be spiritually satisfied with the Lord Jesus Christ, because Jesus can provide all of our needs physically and spiritually. I'm almost finished. Number 8, pushing versus patience. In this word, they said, no matter who gets in the way, the word pushes ahead and stop for no one. If you're on my way to success, then I have to run you down. But ladies and gentlemen, real success is not going to destroy other people. You wait with patience. You wait for the timing of God, because all things are beautiful in God's time. Amen? Don't push it. If it is not yet time, you see, the verse that Brother Jesus said, on ministering, wait. On your ministering, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Unlike the world. The world is so impatient. They want success now. That's why even a Christian prayed, Lord, give me patience. And I want it now. That will never happen. Because patience is a process that you need to suffer. Things that will give patience in your life. So success in God's vocabulary is patience, waiting for the right time that God will give to you what you need, and God will use you at the right place and at the right time. You see, the successful man has learned to learn from his failures and defeats, instead of letting those failures defeat and overwhelm him. You see, a patient man exhibits the traits of success because he can control himself and does not let circumstances control him. That's why when something bad happens, he learned from that. And he do not allow these things to defeat him. According to Winston Churchill, success is never final. Failure is never fatal, but it is the courage to continue that counts. You see, when you fail and you stop, then that's the time that your failure will become fatal. And if you succeed and you stop, then there is no more success that will follow. But if you will keep on keeping on, like the Apostle Paul, one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press, keep on pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Don't you know that even in this world, you see, some people are so worldly and so negative that they cannot even see God's working in nature or the process of how God really works. Like, for example, most successful people started out as failures. Like, do you know Henry Ford? He was the one who made cars. Do you know the first model? I think the T-20, T-40, have no, reverse gear. So it just keeps going forward. And if you will make a car with no reverse gear, people will laugh at you. But that's how Henry Ford started. He started as a failure before he became a success. Then there was this editor of Atlantic Monthly. He was not named, maybe to avoid shame. But there is a 28-year-old poet who sent him his poems, and he said, our magazine has no room for your vigorous verse. And do you know whom he rejected Robert Frost, who went to became very famous in the field of poetry. And then the University of Bern in 1905 turned down a dissertation as being irrelevant and fanciful. It's almost not true. And do you know the author of that dissertation? Well, it was Albert Einstein. The rhetoric teacher of Harrow School in England wrote this on the 16-year-old student report card, a conspicuous lack of success. And that person was Winston Churchill, one of the greatest Englishmen who ever lived. And this man has less than 1 year of formal schooling, failed in business twice, ran for public office, and was defeated 8 times before he became the president of the United States of America, and his name was Abraham Lincoln. You see, you can use failings or failures as an ingredient to success. Do not stop. Keep on keeping on. Keep on serving God. And if you will do that, then you are sure to find success by the grace of God. The successful man does not let adversity defeat him. Pastor, you have given us example of worldly people. No. I just reserve the best for last. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. No matter what happens in your life as a Christian, you keep on keeping on. You keep on pressing. You do not stop. Why? Our labor, whatever we're doing for God, will never be in vain. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. James 1:4. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Why? Satisfied. Because you are a success in the sight of God. And lastly, leading versus following. Leading versus following. Many men have been leaders of many, but unfortunately were not successful because they led people in the wrong direction. Being a leader is not an automatic success. You must learn how to lead in the right way, and you must learn how to follow as you are leading them, because there is one ultimate leader in our life, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Do not set a wrong example. You see, that's why our Wednesday prayer meeting topic is very important. I hope that you will come, because we are talking about child discipline. We're talking about how we will raise up children that will go in the way of the Lord. Children that will, when they grow up, they will be saved. Because we will teach them how to become wise unto salvation. Like what happened to Timothy. We lead them, our children, as we follow Christ. So it is not just about leading, but it is following. You see, being famous or popular does not mean you are a success. Realize also what fame you may have will not last very long. Listen to this. We are living in a fickle world. You may be a hero today, but you will be a villain tomorrow. You see how you know, this life goes. One day you're on top, the next day you're at the bottom. One day they love you, and then the next day they hate you. You see what's happening to in the lives of this, what we call famous people. The world is very fickle. Why? Because the world is pragmatic. What will work for them, they will accept. If you're for them, they love you. If you're against them, they hate you. That's why, even in the Bible it says, Paul says, am I become your enemy because I told you the truth? You may be true. But if you go against them, then they're going to hate you. Out of the will of God, there is no such thing as a success. But in the will of God, there cannot be any failures. Let me close with the quotation of one preacher in America. His name is Bob Jones Sr. He said, success is finding the will of God and doing it. Amen. Finding the will of God for your life, for my life, and then doing it. Because no matter what we do, if that is not God's will, there cannot be real success. But if we find the will of God, how? By meditating upon the Word of God. By making the Word of God a mighty part of our lives, we will find His will. And then He will tell us how to do it. He will give us the courage and the grace that we may be able to do it. Just like the Apostle Paul, if our life is about to end, we can also say that we have fought a good fight. We finish our course. We have kept the faith. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to be successful. But do not be successful in the standard of this world. Let us be successful in the standard of this world. Because when that happens, only the Lord Jesus Christ will be lifted up. And we will not be seen. But when we face the Lord Jesus Christ at the judgment seat of Christ, He knew how to reward His people. Shall we stand up, please? Every head's bowed. We have studied contrast